Okay. Recording. Hi, everybody. Welcome back to My Life in Traffic, the Traveling Singer. How you doing? I am Vangie Gunn, and so glad you are back with me today. Well, today, I am excited because I am interviewing my very first instrumentalist. Now, see, because I'm a singer, I'm a musician, I never say singers and musicians, I say singers and instrumentalists. So I'm calling you that. Ladies and gentlemen, the amazing, the incomparable, the world-renowned Eric Marienthal. Woo-hoo! Welcome, Eric.
Wow, thank you. Thank you very much.
I'm so excited that you are here. I just love your musicianship and everything that you do. And for those of you that don't know, Eric and I have been playing and singing together in a group called Gordon Goodwin's Big Fat Band. And I have the fun and the privilege of, in a couple of my solos, Eric comes out and does his soloing, and then he comes back out and we riff against each other. And it is so fun, and he always beats me. I'm always like, yeah, yeah, yeah. And then he does this thing, and I'm like, okay, fine.
I don't know about that.
We have a good time. I think the last concert we did, was it in Oklahoma?
I don't know. We did a little fat band gig here in Ventura.
That was so fun.
Last year, the drive up gig where yes. You know, instead of people applauding after the song, you know, people would honk their horns, you know.
Yeah.
And we weren't really sure whether we should be saying thank you or to be offended, you know. Usually when somebody honks their horn at you, it's not a good thing, but
or they're flashing their lights.
That was good. Yes.
It was fun. But I think prior to the pandemic, we had our last big fat concert was in Oklahoma. And big huge stage, and so Eric and I were riffing off with each other, and it was so fun that I remember I just walked over to you and I hugged you afterwards or something, or I did a spin around you or something. I was so inspired and had such a blast. Sorry. I got a picture, but I'll throw it in on this.
Yeah. Wow.
Okay. But I miss it, and I'm excited about the world opening up again. I know we have a couple of gigs coming up, everybody, so we'll post about those later. But how have you been during this quarantine and crazy, weird year?
It's been, you know, it's been interesting. I'm lucky because I do a lot of different sort of things. The room that I'm in now is my studio. All the studio stuff is on that side of my computer. But we had this room built, my wife and I, years ago, probably back in 2013, 2014, maybe. And, you know, before that, I would play and practice and do all my things in the house, you know. Yeah. Once, you know, one kid moved out, I kind of took over that room, and then another kid moved out, and that room was bigger, so maybe I moved over there, and I did a majority of my practice in other places. That we have a community college not far away, so I would, you know, spare everybody that, but I would definitely play, and as, like, the home recording thing became more and more important, I would, you know, I turned one of those rooms into a studio, essentially, and we built this room. Actually, my wife Leanne and I affectionately refer to this room as our marriage saver. You know, it's in the backyard, in the back of the backyard, in fact, so I can be out here, you know, trying reeds and playing on tracks and doing whatever, and nobody's the wiser. So so it's cool. I just love it. And so a lot of my work had been out here anyway. I have an online school called Artist Works, and I have over 500 students there. Ooh. So that keeps me pretty busy. And then just, you know, as things kind of shut down more in terms of being able to go anywhere, other things just sort of became a little busier. You know, I mean, I you know, 2019, I was on the road over 200 days, and that was about average, you know. And so needless to say, 2020 was a bit fewer.
Yeah. I think
and Yeah. In fact, to this day, I still haven't been on an airplane. I mean, I'm playing a festival in 2 weeks in Cabo San Lucas. And that'll be the first time will have been on an airplane since March of 2020. So
Wow.
it's
Yeah.
a big festival. In fact, I have a friend, well, Lee Ridenour, is also playing at this festival. We were on the phone yesterday and he was saying, yeah, we kind of wish, and he's in the same boat, he hasn't traveled either. And he said, I kind of wish our first flight back wasn't like to a foreign country, I wish
I
it was
know.
like to Bakersfield or something.
Yeah. Now, which festival is that? Can you say?
Well, it's Warren Hills, Cabo San Lucas Jazz Festival, I
Yeah.
think it is,
I forget what it's called too. Cancun Jazz Festival, Cabo Jazz Festival. It's one of those. Yeah. That's great. Well, we hopefully they're selling out. I'm sure they are because everybody's dying to get out these days. But hopefully everything will be safe and smart and they'll handle it properly. But that's pretty exciting, actually. So
I'm excited to, the only all the live, well, live playing I've done has either just been literally right here in this chair in front of this, camera, or at a club called Spigatini. I play there once a month. They built an outdoor thing. So
okay.
each month I have a guest artist play. Rick Bronze doing it in 2 weeks, actually. And Peter White did it recently. So each month we do
How
that. So.
fun. I saw Aubrey did that with you this last month, right?
Right. Yeah, exactly
She's
right. Yeah, Aubrey
awesome.
Wilkins.
Yeah, I've done some sessions with her. So that her voice is amazing as well as her trombone playing. Yeah, and she's just a force. I love her. In fact, she's crazier than me. So it's kind of fun to have us in the same room. But you know what? I want to read a little bit of your bio, just touches of your career. And okay, get ready, everybody. It's unbelievably amazing. I can't think of other adjectives right now, but you went to Berkeley in Boston, right? Awesome. My daughter's trying to go there. So, you know, any tips you got, that'd be great.
Wow.
Let's see. Yeah, we're excited. You have performed in over 75 different countries. Come on. So that means even some little random countries, right? You have 14 or 15 solo CDs. How many?
15, 15.
15. Wow. Okay, hundreds of records, films, television shows, and commercial jingles. Let's see, you've played with New Orleans trumpeter Al Hurt, Elton John, Barbara Streisand. I always have to pause for Barbara Streisand. Okay, Billy Joel, Stevie Wonder, oh my goodness, Dionne Warwick, Burt Bacharach, Aaron Neville, oh, Johnny Mathis, Dave Grusin, you mentioned Lee Ritenour, George Duke, ooh, that's cool, Patty Austin, Lou Rawls, David Lee Roth, yeah, baby, and so many more, including Gordon Goodwin's Big Fat Band. But the biggest thing, one of the bigger things you've done in your lifetime has been being one of the members of Chick Corea's Electric Band. And I have someone kind of on the inside of your life who told me that you're probably the most recorded saxophone player with Chick that he ever had. Is that right?
Well, I've been told that several times. I was in Chick's band for 35 years and we made a lot of records and did all kinds of different things. So, over 35 years. So, I haven't really vetted it, if anybody's recorded or played more with Chick, I'd be surprised.
And I'm really sorry about his loss or your loss of him this year. That was a pretty devastating blow to everybody.
Yeah, to everybody, absolutely. Those of us, the four of us in the electric band, we were, all those years, my entire career really was sort of surrounded around that, I just feel incredibly, it still feels surreal, but feel so incredibly fortunate to have been in the band and been with Chick in the band in so many other situations. He's the one who got me my first record deal. He produced my first record. He, you know, just all kinds of different things. We actually have a live record that is now just finished in terms of mixing and getting all the cover art and everything together. So that'll be out soon. I haven't even heard when they're going to put it out. But it's a live record that we did over the course of a lot of touring in 2018, I believe.
Oh, wonderful.
So and it's really smoking. We're really proud of it. And,
so he was more like family to you, not just a gig.
Oh yeah. I mean, you know, 35 years. I mean, we watched everybody's kids grow up, you know. Yeah. My daughter, who's, you know, about to turn 34, you know, when she was 6 months old, Leanne and she flew to New Orleans to hear us play at Tipitina's, and we were there for a bit. So that, and, you know, oh yeah. I mean, and all the members of the band are married with kids, and his kids now. His kids, a lot of our kids have kids. And,
I was quite a family. Talked about maybe trying to stay together in some form, or
We, you know, people have asked us about it. Quite frankly, we are doing a tribute to Chick at Jazz Lincoln Center next January, and it's going to be several different kind of configurations of groups and people that worked with Chick. The thing about our band is that it was. You know, how could you play Chick-fil-A music like that without Chick, you know?
Right.
For that, it looks like Herbie's going to play. And we've talked about it, the four of us, and if we were to do anything, we would just do it without keyboards, you know? I mean, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
Somebody else to. Yeah. So, but we could do it. It's possible. So, you know, it's a little raw still, so we're
your career is incredible. I didn't even finish all of it. You had referred to your school that you teach, Artist Works, which that was already doing online schooling way before pandemic. So for you, it's just, drop in the bucket. This is what I've been doing, right?
I started with Artist Works in 2015, and it's really fantastic. You know, people, students subscribe to the school, and then they are privy to all the different, there's hundreds of lessons and tracks and PDFs and all kinds of different things, and then they the whole school is based on video exchanges where a student will videotape themselves playing a lesson or whatever, and then I watch it and I respond and send back a response. And so, you know.
Nice. So never in person? I mean, never like this where it's live or you're actually talking. That's interesting. So it works for your schedule, just whenever you can do it, you do it.
Yeah, I mean, there were, when I was traveling, I would do a ton in my hotel room.
Oh, that's so great. Yeah. Now, would you ever get backed up and have like 50 videos that you needed to review?
Yes. I don't know about 50. Fortunately, not everybody, you know, for whatever reason, a small percentage, I'd say, let me think, maybe 10%, 12% or so. People actually take advantage of the video exchanges, you know.
Okay.
I mean, if all 500, Paul Gilbert, one of the guitar instructors, you know, has thousands of, I don't know how many thousands, but he has thousands of students, you know. So, you know, and Peter Erskine is a drum instructor, and George Whitty is a piano instructor. So it's a cool deal. But,
yeah, it really is. We got to visit their facilities a couple years ago. We went up
that's
there.
That's right. Yeah.
And thought, it's phenomenal. Yeah, I was super impressed by it. So, and they have it really just dialed in. So having you there is great, though. I'm sure it brings in so many students. So that's great. Well, so then during this pandemic time, has there been anything outside of music or any hobby that you've kind of kicked up and started to love? I've got a list.
Hobby. Well, one really cool hobby is, you know, been helping babysit my little year and a half old granddaughter.
She's so cute.
So that has been, you know, it's hard to talk about all the great things that have gone on during the pandemic. You know, you can't do that because, you know, so many people are.
Oh yeah.
Everybody's, you know, really suffering through it. So, but it has been a real blessing to be home more. I just think, you know, man, when she was first born in 2019, I was gone a lot, you know, but you know, when March of 2020 hit, she was only 8 months old. So I've seen her. I see her. Katie and Alex, my son-in-law, lived right down the street. Literally, they bought a house 2 miles down the street. So we almost literally see them every day, and we officially babysit twice a week. And, but we unofficially babysit a whole lot more than that,
Yeah, that's great. That is great. So, it is true with the pandemic and COVID and quarantine and all of it. It's been awful for so many people. And it's in essence, in a lot of ways, just kind of decimated the music industry. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we do see light at the end of the tunnel, which is nice. We've got some gigs. You've got gigs and a handful of things. But it's forced all of us to kind of look a little deeper at what we are grateful for outside of music. And the thing is, for me, for you, music isn't just a hobby. It's not just something fun. It's like the right half of my body. You know, if I didn't do music, it would be like scooping out my heart, right? And same. So this last year has been a real introspective time for all of us to find other ways to stay motivated and grateful and having forward motion. And so a little one for me is cooking. I never cooked. I mean, hardly. I cooked on Thanksgiving, usually in the past, because I was always too busy. So this last year, I've been cooking and I love it. I'm getting super creative with it. I'm understanding spices and all that kind of stuff. So that's the thing that when I'm feeling it, because there's plenty of yuck too that we've been through this year. But when I try to focus in on those kind of things. So is there any kind of side thing outside of that beautiful little granddaughter? I mean, I heard you once say you garden. Is this true?
Oh, my wife Leanne she's a horticulturist.
So, oh, that's right.
Yeah, she is a professional landscape designer. So I get to look out. All the cool stuff is on that side of the camera, so I'm afraid, but I get to look out into our beautiful backyard with, it's her, test garden, and it's just the most amazing, especially this time of year. It's just, all those crazy roses and everything, and in the front yard has also got the whole major scene, she's, way. It's her thing,
That's good. Well, it sounds like you guys were already pretty well dialed in for this type of a world. And how fortunate for you to have your daughter and her little one near you.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And my son is going to be getting married really, really soon. They haven't actually set a date, but they're going to do it. My daughter's wedding was the whole, Cinderella thing, but Rob is going to, they're going to go the opposite direction. So we're kind of waiting to find out, which day of the week they're going to get married. They're going to get married really, really soon. That much we know.
I'm just going to call you, Dad, the wedding's in 3 days. Be there.
I would not be the slightest bit surprised, But they live about 10 miles away also. Oh. And my future daughter-in-law, Taylor, is just the sweetest thing in the whole
world. Wow. Okay, you sound really blessed, really fortunate with all of this. That's wonderful.
Yeah, absolutely. Just trying to, keep everybody healthy and, all that.
Absolutely. All right, well, let me get into some of the fun, interesting questions with you, okay?
Okay.
So in your career, what would you say? Oh, and this is going to be hard for you. You've been to 75 countries. All right, but really try. What would you say is your favorite or favorite area, city, town, country, whatever that you've been to? Now, not necessarily that you've where the venue is, we'll get to that. But let's say some place that was just, it blew your mind.
Wow.
this is always the reaction.
Let's see. Well, Saint-Tropez, France was really spectacular. Lugano, Switzerland, and Locarno also is a lake. Everybody thinks about Lake Como, and Lugano because it's a jazz festival. But half hour from between the two, frankly, is this smaller lake called Locarno, and it's just the most amazing. I played there 4 or 5 times actually. So that was really incredible. As a place in general, we really loved New Zealand a lot. I mean, it was just one of the most friendly places we had ever been, and just gorgeous and so awesome. And then Japan. I mean, I've been to Japan literally over 100 times.
Oh my
And it's just because of that. I mean, it's just the Japanese are just so great as an audience, and bringing American and musicians from all over the world over. And there's so many great venues, and just, I mean, I've been so many times that I've got a lot of friends there and a lot of musician friends there. And it's just, it's a very, very special place. But yeah, I could go on for a while. There's a
That's a
lot
good list. I love it. Yeah, I'm like, keep going,
of
keep going. I wonder if you also determine what you like based on, well, I like the food there, I like the weather there, I like the sights there, or if it's an friendly people or whatever.
Well, there's a place on the Amalfi Coast, in southern Italy, that I got to play twice. I mean, speaking of food, that it was just ridiculous, I mean, when you go to, if you're judging places on food, it's hard, to, especially, I mean, northern Italy has a different kind of a thing, obviously. Southern Italy, Napoli, it's more about, the pasta and things. But then Bologna, they always say that's like where the best food, I'm sure there'd be plenty of arguments about that, but that's where the best food is in Italy. And I remember one time with Chick, actually, we did a gig, and we were to go to a restaurant after the concert, and which was going to be way after they were already closed. They stayed open for us, and kept the chef and the staff, and we went and had this meal that they made just for us in this ridiculous place. And the wine bottles came out, and there was no labels on it. We said, "Oh, what's this?" And they said, "Oh, it's from the winery over there."
Over there, we don't remember.
The vines right there,
Oh my goodness. So they stomped them and did it themselves.
Well, I don't know if it was their winery, but it came from that town. Yeah, I mean, literally,
That's amazing. And so how long did that dinner last?
not long enough. It was probably 3 hours, but it could have gone on all night. It was just one of those, like, ridiculous things.
Well, this is the one place I have not been is Italy. Well, not, I mean, there's a lot of places, but that is my goal, all-time goal. And I almost been there like 3 times and the gigs always got canceled. So
Oh,
yeah, we'll get there. I think so. Yeah, one of
yeah.
these days. So, all right. Well, so on that same vein, what would be some of your favorite venues where you're walking into it, the sound is going to be great, maybe the crowd, the atmosphere. What do you say to that?
Well, as far as those things go, I mean, every year, for several years now, I play for a week at the Cotton Club in Tokyo. And my band and I go, we play 4 nights, and the last night is always New Year's Eve. We didn't do it last year. I'm sure it's unlikely we'll do it this year, but next year again, well, they've already said once we can open up and, bring people back in, we'll do it. But the staff there is incredible, and we know people there, and we do 8 shows, and so and it's a little bit smaller than the Blue Note. It's owned by the same people, but the Blue Note, of course, is where the Fat Band has played a whole bunch of times, and sound there is great. The staff there is ridiculously great, and they just make you feel like $1 million. It's
They
really
do.
fun. I mean, there have been some pretty ridiculous venues. I played one time in Lyon, France, in this outdoor venue that was literally from the Roman Empire. It was carved into the mountains. People were sitting on the rock. The rock was, they've been chiseled out of the side of the mountain. That's pretty cool. There's a club in Switzerland, in no, France. Oh, that was, outside of Saint-Tropez, France, it's called the Dracula Club, and it's a small little place, but it's owned by a wealthy gentleman, and he brings artists there just to play, and if it holds 200 people, I'd be surprised, but it's up the hill, up the side of the mountain from about a half hour from Saint-Tropez, which is just this the most unbelievable, incredible. So
Yes, anything about France, man. I've been to Paris and the south of France twice, and I love it. I
right.
love it. I think I would move there if I could. I really would. Perform. New
It
York.
depends. I mean, there's so many, I mean, right here in LA, the Hollywood Bowl is just, it's ridiculous in just how gigantic it is. 18,000 seats, and I think there's another 10 that they can squeeze up on top. And so it's this massive thing. So that's always like a real thrill. As far as venues, I mean, the Blue Note in New York is really fun because you just kind of, you're parked there for a week, and it's real small, and it's just kind of in the middle of, the energy. You don't even have to try to play. Just put your horn in your mouth and stuff comes out just because
You're in New York.
you're in New York.
Yeah.
And then frankly, I'm not just trying to plug it, but Spaghettini here in Seal Beach.
Like away.
The sound is amazing. Always do really well. The staff is super great, and they've invested a ton of money in their sound system. So go, it's really fantastic. So and it's my home base. I play there every. So
What day are you booked out on particular days each month? Or, I
pretty
mean,
much.
I know you are, but is it a Friday, Saturday, Sunday?
It's usually a Monday, the last Monday of the month.
Okay. Last Monday of the month. And I'll put that on the end of this so that people can find the website and get tickets and go see you. Yeah. We played there once with Little Fat. I remember a couple of years ago at Christmas, and it was wonderful. It was tight and small. And when I got up on stage, I was kind of like,
Well, the
doo.
cool thing now is that they've built a whole beautiful patio thing outside with the
Oh,
stage and everything, and it's really great. I mean, it's really
nice.
sounds cool. It sounds
Yeah.
awesome. And yeah, Lee Ritenour just confirmed, but he's going to be doing it with me
Oh,
on
that's good.
July, and yeah.
Yeah, that's something probably too now, a result of quarantine and the pandemic is all the venues finding a way to do these outside performance areas that are good. And it's nice. They're kind of popping up. I know Vibrato's doing that, and now Spaghettini. So that's great. Really wonderful.
Yeah, I'm trying to.
good. So, so good. Okay. Hi, Joey.
I had somebody tell me something about the Beacon Theater. Have you played there?
Many times, yeah. The Beacon up in up Broadway. I think it's Broadway in 96 or so. Giant theater, yeah. Yeah, it was really great. You know, Lincoln Center, I guess it's a 30 blocks north of Lincoln Center, whatever. Yeah, the Beacon is a classic old huge theater. I remember one time one of the the stagehands yelled at me for touching a monitor. Yeah, I wanted to move my monitor a little bit, you know, trying to think I'm helping out. And, you know, it's a serious union house, so you can't mess with their gig, you know. So I understood. It's a thing.
Yeah, it drives me a little nuts.
Very important, folks. My father-in-law was a stagehand here in Hollywood.
Oh, and, okay.
So, yeah.
Wow, it's in the family, in all the family.
Yeah.
You guys are just in this business. So that's wonderful. So do you have any good stories? One thing with my guests here watching us, there's a thing we call road life and real life. And road life is, it's interesting. Sometimes it's just about getting on airplanes and getting to the hotel and then trying to find some food and then getting on stage, you do the gig, you have a little after party and then you get back to the hotel. So it's different, it's not real life. And yet it's real for people like you who tour over 200 days a year. So I'm sure you have a system, which I'll get to that in a little bit, but I'm wondering, do you have any either crazy stories backstage, offstage, or any scary stories backstage, off stage?
We had a tour. There have been quite a few over all the years. You know, with Chick, we had one Europe tour that we ended up calling the Nine Lives tour because we almost died. Like, so. we were in the bus one time and in the middle of the night, the bus driver just had to swerve over it swerved to the point where, you know, guys were falling out of the bunks and the freeway bridge like ended right in front of them, you know. That's the easy one. We did one gig once. I was in the middle of a solo and it was I think in Spain in the middle of it, you know, in that theater, 3,000 people or whatever, and the tour manager comes running out on stage and gets, you know, flags us down, stop playing in the middle of the show. And he runs over to Chick and says something. He looks at us and says, you know, follow me now.
Oh.
You know? And we walked off and there had been a bomb scare. So we go out the back of the theater. And so the audience is kind of like at this point now they're eventually on the street and looking at us, wondering if we're going to go back in. The promoter's trying to get Chick to go back in. And Chick, you know, he said, the promoter says in Spanish, you know, the Spanish accent, oh, it happens all the time. Don't worry, it's no big deal, you know. And Chick said, yeah, but what if this is the time? You know?
The time, right.
Yeah. But on that same tour, the probably the scariest thing that ever happened was we were on a flight from London to Leeds, England. And very long story short, we take off and the one of the tires blew and it the rubber was sucked into the back engine, and it was a type of plane that has the two engines in the back, like a Southwest type flight, you know, DC.
Yeah.
And the engine blew up and literally, and we had just taken off and the plane is like doing this, you know.
Right.
And the drummer, Gary Novak, was sitting right next to that seat, you know. And I'm he's like, you know, there's flames coming out the other side of the window. And we thought, you know, we thought that was it. I mean, really the plane is like flipping out, there's fire and the flight attendants like flip out, you know. Every time those guys start doing a safety drill, I think, yeah, I've seen you guys in action. give me this, like, we'll take care of you kind of thing. So it's at night, we you know, the pilot very calmly, once he stabilizes the plane, explains what happened and says we're going to be making an emergency landing, and now the flight attendants will be showing you the brace position, you know. Looking out the window to they had closed the runway and all the emergency vehicles with the lights were foaming it down, you know. We land, but we had to land on one side, and we landed okay. But we had to go out the emergency chutes, and I went off the wing and the whole bit. By the time they actually gathered everybody up, because they once we got off onto the tarmac, they said, run, 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 in case the plane caught fire,
Oh my God.
So they finally gathered everybody up, put them on a bus, we get to the terminal. They had closed the entire terminal at Heathrow Airport, right? And I see CNN cameras, and I'm thinking, we're trying to, and this is in the 90s, nobody had a cell phone or anything. So we're all trying to get to the pay phones to call our families because they're about to see this, plane that made an emergency landing, and some people are getting off the plane and stuff. So yeah, that happened.
That's scary. So let me ask you, how long until you got back on the plane to go where you were going?
Well, the funny thing is, we were there for 3 hours, and they finally did get another plane. And the manager, we didn't have a gig the next day. I think we were off the next day, and the manager said. And it was the longest tour we had ever done. It was a 3 month tour, and it was the only flight that Chick wasn't with us.
He had done
some solo gig, so he wasn't there. So the road manager said, there's another plane. Everybody's getting on it, and we can do that, or if you guys kind of just want to stay here and figure it out tomorrow. And I won't mention who it was, but one of the guys in the band doesn't dig flying, and he was flipped out. We ended up taking a bus the next day.
Yeah, I think I would have been pretty freaked out. Probably would have been crying.
Lightning doesn't strike twice comes to mind, but.
Yeah, that's a good point. Oh gosh, but yeah, that would be a little bit jarring, slightly.
Oh yeah.
Man, I think a lot about it. Every time we take off, I think about, I'm always just like, okay, let's go. Good. Lifting. Good. Good. All right. Uh-huh. Yeah. Good. 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 Yeah, I don't know why. It just always makes me a little bit nervous that taking off and landing, we can do this. Those are good stories. Yeah. Mostly I hope I never experience that. Yeah. Man, oh man. So where do you hope you can get back to, whether for a gig or to take Leanne or your family? Where do you want to go back to? I mean, again, you've traveled so much. Is there even one corner of the earth that you haven't seen?
So many of our, we've been married for almost 40 years now. And so many of our vacations have been, centered on gigs. And it's cool, actually, because, you could do a gig and
it's the best.
You can go on vacation, basically.
Yes. Yeah.
Extended and whatever,
Yeah.
So, but we talked very seriously about, wanting to do a safari at some point, So that's on the list. We've never actually, Leanne lived in Paris for the better part of a year when she was young, modeling. I played in Paris a number of times over the years, but we've never been to Paris together. We've been to France together, but never there. So that's one that's actually about to get planned here now. And it's interesting because, to be perfectly honest, when all this happened last year, I travel a lot, obviously, and I have for an awfully long time. And so the last thing I want to do is go travel,
Right.
I mean, we go to Ohio, we go up to, we do our, we have our little things, but, getting on, except for probably going to Hawaii or somewhere,
right.
Getting on a plane, just doesn't sound like a fun thing to do.
Right. It's the last thing you want to do. I get it.
Right.
So being home for you is vacation.
Yeah, but exactly. But now, after 15 months of being, mm-hmm. Being here, we talk about it more. So, we always have a great time in New York. So that's, a real, real fun. Every year we go to London together. I play a week at the at a club in Soho. So last year we turned it into a long vacation and we went up into the Lake District, so that was our 2019, I guess.
Right, right. But, now let me ask you though, with this forced pandemic or forced quarantine that we've all had, do you want to change moving forward in terms of, Do you want to dive back in to as busy as you were? Do you want to get more picky, do less? What are your thoughts on that moving forward?
You know, I it's just such a blessing to be a musician, and have that be something that you do for your living. Every day I get to wake up and feel good about what I'm going to go do when I go work, you know. And being able to get up and, you know, I always joke about the fact that, you know, I look across the backyard and, you know, the 40 feet from my studio and I think, oh, let's check the traffic today. No, a squirrel, you know, there's a cat, you know. Ultimately, it really is. It's fun to record music for people and with people, of course, and perform, you know, with people, you know, virtually. Getting to perform with people in real life, in front of real life,
yes,
breathing people,
yes,
is just such a rush. And when we did the first gig just at Spaghettini, after what had been so many months of not playing live at all, I realized how important it is, not just from an ego standpoint, like standing there in front of an audience and having them,
sure,
applaud for you, but just it's a connection, you know, and maybe even more so with the other members of the band, because the connection with you and the audience, and that's, you're trying to create that, but the music is, you know, and the musicians that are creating it together, that's really a connection. That's a soulful thing.
Mm-hmm.
And my band and I have been playing together for a real long time. And it's, so that was almost bringing me to tears, you know, just like, oh man, you know, oh, I don't want to stop yet. What are you talking about? You know? It's hard to say, well, I'll do this and I won't do that. And you know,
right. I know. I had someone ask me that. Are you going to be more choosy? And I go, yes, I don't know. You know, there's something in us as freelance musicians. Again, we're so lucky to do this, but it's hard to say no. Mm-hmm. So I think that one thing I have learned, Eric, I was psycho busy too, pre-pandemic. My days were 12-hour days, 15-hour days, where I was gone. And something about a little bit of extra rest and being able to really take care of my voice rather than managing because I'm getting no sleep and I'm super stressed out has been a real eye-opener for me. So I think as I'm going into the world opening, I want to do all that I can do again and perform and travel and all that, but I want to be healthy. So I don't know. I've kind of had a different viewpoint a little bit on it, but I understandably also, I really miss it. I can't wait to get on stage with you and riff off, you know? So it's a different place to be because we need it with our friends and audience and just as musicians, but we also need to value not being as busy. I don't know. You see the battle in my own head. So there you go. Well, let me ask you also, how, I know you practice. I got to tell everybody, Eric is the most practicing instrumental or musician that I know. Anytime we were on a gig, I would walk by his hotel room and hear him practicing. Yeah. And so it's...
Sorry, by the way.
It's okay. I know. I was in the next room. Sheesh. No, it's fine. It's amazing. It's inspiring, actually. And so... I was just talking to Gordon about this, that I vocalize every day, but I don't sing. I don't rear back and do my thing. And I said, I need to start doing that. I need to sing my gig songs. I need to sing all the songs like that I sing with Janice Siegel or whoever, Whitney Houston, that really get me there because I want to make sure I'm tip-top shape when we get back into gigging. So have you felt that at all? I know you practice, but do you feel like a little rusty? Okay.
Oh man. Yeah. I mean, I mentioned Lee Ritenour a bit ago. We were on the phone talking. We laughed, but we felt the same way. But, you know, I used to say that practicing, rather than playing live, it's playing live, but you're not practicing. You're not really, you know, you're not really diving in and practicing, you know, with the metronome and scales and really
right,
kind of, you know, doing it. And And I realized that that not doing like live gigs and only recording is a different discipline, different pressure, I guess, or whatever. But long story short is that I have to practice a lot more to stay where I was. When you're on the road or you're playing, and yeah. So consequently, and there have been times, I'm doing a lot of other, kinds of things here and where I might go a couple of days or a few days even without really playing a whole lot, and I really notice it. I mean, I didn't when I first there was 3 months where I didn't do any gigs whatsoever and just recording and whatever. And when I went to that first gig, I was like, holy moly, I got to the first tune. It's my band, so I'm playing most of the time, and it's just a quartet, So I was like, trumpet players talk about, you're on your teeth, when your chops are just fried, man. And so I drove home thinking, that ain't gonna happen ever again.
Right. Kick your own butt. I know. I get you on that. So yeah, I think we're all kind of dealing with that. But the gigs are right there. So we gotta get ourselves back into shape. So I want to share really quick. I'm going to share the screen so that our audience can see your website, if that's all right with you. Just for real quick here. Wait, is this it? It better be. And there it is. So everybody, if you're looking for where Eric's going to be performing, or you just want some history of Eric up here, there's merch. Buy merch, buy merch, buy merch. And his bio, tour dates, all of it. But it is a beautiful website. Look at that. Oh, you have a YouTube channel now. Awesome.
I have a really good friend in Singapore named Daniel Chia, and Daniel's been really great at helping me join the 90s. He's really
During the
incredible, and he Daniel Chia's check out his playing. He's a great saxophone player as well, and so he's been really helpful with this website and with
That's
my
great.
other online.
It's beautiful. So now, what's new? What's coming up for you outside of Warren Hills Jazz Festival? You got a new album, right? That just came out.
Well, the album, I did a record that came out last September.
Okay. Well, that's
It
just
came out because we haven't really even started, doing much with it. But
in the pandemic world, that's just
I did it with Randy Brecker, the great trumpet player.
right. Let's see, what's it called? The album is called Double Dealin'. Yeah. Yeah. So everybody go check that out. Randy Brecker, incredible, another amazing instrumentalist and legendary trumpeter. And I bet you guys sound amazing together. So we will go check that out. And anything else that we need to know? We got to see you at Spaghettini every month. And more and more gigs are going to be opening up. But personally, I am just excited to get on stage with you again. And we have a really good gig. I hope you're going to be there in August. And yes, okay, yay. I'm like, at the Redlands Bowl, the big fat band, whoop. And so I'm really excited about that because I miss playing with all you guys very, very much. But Eric, thank you so much for being my very first musician instrumentalist on My Life in Traffic, the traveling musician. I'll change it. And for giving me a little bit of your time and your words of wisdom and your history and all of that. I just thank you so much.
My pleasure, Finch. Thank you for having me.
You
Appreciate it.
are welcome. Eric, you're amazing. All right, you guys, take care. We'll see you at the next episode. Stay tuned. A lot is coming down the pipe, and we're excited about everything coming up. All right, take care.